Thank you. I appreciate that. Hi, Devin. How are you? Yeah, sensation. All right, so I'm not going to lie. I'm a little more nervous than normal because for the majority of guys, I don't know. Like, there's a small section of, like, seniors and then row T that I know them. But by and large, most of you guys are strangers, and I want you to like me. I want to like you. It's like this awkward first date, you know. It's like, I'm trying to, here's a little joke or a little dance, and, you know, I hope it goes well. This is what LeBrie must feel like every day, just hoping people like him, and, you know. He's probably not even here, is he? Is he here? He's not here, so it's okay. Oh, you are? You probably won't be in class, though, so it's okay. All right. Here's my question for you guys, right? And it's kind of a simple one, right? What would it take for you to embrace your entire story? Let me, again, just say it again. What would it take for you to embrace your entire story? And you're probably wondering, what does that mean? What is your story? So let me just say it in another way. What would it take for you to acknowledge, for you to accept all of the good, all of the bad, all of the ugly of your life up until this point? And not just kind of acknowledge it, but accept it and embrace it and know that it is a large part of your makeup for today, and it probably will even impact a large part of your trajectory. What would it take? The good stuff, I think we're really comfortable with. We like talking about the good stuff of when, like, we were in middle school and we're playing baseball and it's the last inning and you're up to bat and you knock it out and you get the go-ahead home run. We like that one. We don't like to finish the story of when then we were pitching and we gave up the grand slam. I see you, Kyle. But we like those good stories. We like the ones that are like, you know, make you feel good and warm and fuzzy and, you know, people look at you and everyone's smiling and it's this little connective moment. It's nice. We don't necessarily like to talk about some of the bad stuff, right? We don't like to talk about sometimes the brokenness or the hurt or the pain. Maybe sometimes we do if we think, if I share this, if I share this and this, this would be like, you know, vulnerable. Maybe she'll look at me and think, ooh, he's strong. He's strong, but he's in touch with his emotions. And, you know, all the while, we're just doing this so that you'll, like, want to hug or something. So that's what Kerner told me works in Holden. But we get that, right? We play it like a game, sadly. Right? So ladies, that's true. If you see the guy and he's doing like the, oh, it was so hard, and they're not real tears, he's lying. It's part of his game. Sorry, guys. It's just true. But then there's also like the ugly, right? There's the ugly in life, and the ugly in life is, it's the stuff that you don't even like to talk about. It's the part of your own story, the part of your family, the part of your own reality where you don't like to engage with honestly. You don't really dare greatly in that avenue at all. You don't necessarily want to talk about it with anybody, and when they ask you that simple question, you rebuke it. It's the part of your own story that you don't necessarily even read. It's the chapter that you want to just kind of advance. It's the chapter you want to skip. It's the moment in the history of your family that you just want to bypass. But what would it take for us to embrace all the good and all the bad and all the ugly, knowing that God has accepted it, that God is redeeming it, that God is actively working in and through all of those things? And I know even in saying that, just by some of your guys' little side conversations right now, you're thinking, but Murph, you don't know my story. Like, you don't know the brokenness. You don't know, again, the addiction. You don't know my family. You don't know this. And you're right. I have no idea. No clue. I don't know what your addiction is like. I don't know what your cutting is like. I don't know what your eating disorder is like. I don't know what that is like. I don't have no clue. I can only know in as much as, again, I've experienced some of those things and I haven't for some of those. But I also know this truth: pain is not relative. I don't know what your story is like. I know mine. And I know, again, by the time I was, again, a sophomore, right, that I had gone through three, again, divorces, two state correctional facilities, prisons, right, and one closet. And here's what I mean by that. So my parents, they got married, but then they got divorced. And I wasn't really around for that at the beginning because somehow dad wanted to like join some hippie like socialist commune up in Bakersfield. And everyone's like sharing their resources and all the material goods. And then they want to like share wives. And my mom wasn't cool with that, right? So she bounced and that ended quickly. But then they got remarried. Then they got remarried and we grew up in the church and dad was like the, you know, the pastor and mom was the choir director. That was the context and that's all we knew. That's it. And then that story changed pretty quickly when I'm watching Star Wars and the pastor simply kind of brings us into the room and begins to tell us that our dad was going to go away for a while. And they just kind of packaged it as like a little vacation, a little, you know, business trip. They didn't really want to tell us about the grievous acts that my dad had done against humanity and that he was going to be incarcerated serving two 10-year sentences concurrently. You're six. You can't really understand that. I just wanted to go back and watch the Ewoks. That's all I was watching. Every time I see Star Wars, I'm always like, but it was at that scene when my life changed. But I remember what it was like. So then they got divorced there. But what was interesting is they got divorced, but yet somehow there was still this process of like restoration for the next five, six, whatever years. Every weekend we would go and we would visit, you know, James, my dad. We would visit my dad in the prison. And we would spend our holidays there and your birthdays and every significant moment we would spend there. And it was weird because I thought it was normal. You'd come back and it's like, hey, what did you do? And Johnny's talking about, I did ASO and I did this. And it's like, man, I got frisked again because they thought I was going to bring in a shank. And then I played Pac-Man with some other like inmate. But he taught me how to, those weren't normal conversations. I thought they were. But then things again took another weird turn. We had a family little meeting when we thought our family was kind of good. And then my dad decides to just kind of say, hey, guys, I want to let you know, like just in all truth, like I love you guys, but I got to be about me. And I've been living a lie for far too long. So I'm going to go and I'm going to leave you guys. I'm going to pursue an alternative lifestyle. And I had no idea what that meant. That's like early 90s lingo. So I heard alternative. I was like, you like Nirvana, like that's cool, like we can go to concerts. And so I was like, I don't get that. And my dad comes out of the closet, and this is like in the early 90s. Your reaction just made me laugh. He was like, did he just say that? Yeah, he did. So my dad came out of the closet, so my dad's gay. And it was one of these, like, now this is like early 90s where this isn't trending. This isn't like a social thing. Like, I didn't know any other parents. I didn't know any friends or any other families where this was normal. But I remember what it was like Wednesday night going to bed, and then Thursday what it was like coming to school. And my world had shifted completely. And I remember, again, the personal kind of pain and the hurt and the brokenness that was caused on our family. I remember what that was like. And I remember again that those years, again, if these were supposed to be the best years of my life, that's what everyone kept saying. I was like, I'm gonna get stabbed in the future. Like, this is just not good. I'm 16 and all of this has happened. This is no bueno. Like, I've peaked out really early. This is not good. And I remember these continual questions because you can imagine, like I had some issues. I had some anger. I had some authority issues. I had some trust. I had a lot of issues, whatever you want to say, right? Then I had some stuff I had to work through. And people kept asking me these questions like, but when are you going to be okay? Like, when are you going to, you know, kind of move on? When are you going to get over it? And part of it, I just wanted to deck them. I wanted to have like some come to Jesus moments right there. Like my sin nature was strong because I hated those questions. Like, but Joel, like, when do you just want to like move on from this? And I was like, well, it's not like I'm trying to, but I didn't know how to kind of grow. I didn't know how to move in this story. I didn't know how to accept this as reality. And so even when I show up kind of hungover to this church camp, And my leader, God bless him, he just kind of looks at me square and he says, Joel, when are you going to be mature? I was like, ugh. Like, when are you gonna be mature? It's like my response. I take issue with that, right? But when are you going to, again, be mature? Like, when are you gonna get better? Like, when are you gonna get well? And that question just kind of messed with me, but for all the right reasons. Because up until that point, I wasn't able to, again, just simply accept all of the good, all of the bad, and all of the ugly in my story. And there was this text that continued to come up, and it's a text I just want to kind of read and lean into today. So it's found in John 5. John 5, starting in verse 5. Now, one who had been there had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" "Sir," the invalid replied, "I have no one here to help me in the pool when the water is stirred. While I'm trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me." Then Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." At once the man was cured. He picked up his mat and walked. The day on which this took place was a Sabbath, so the Jews said, "The man who had been healed, it's the Sabbath, and law forbids this to carry your mat." But the man replied, "The man who said, made me well, said this to me, 'Pick up your mat and walk.'" Now, it's a story that we're probably all too familiar with, because we hear it mainly in this like theological kind of story. And what I would ask for just a couple minutes is that you actually acknowledge it more than just the sentiment, more than just some folklore, for those of you guys that hold that position. But that you get into the human experience of what's here, because to be honest, if I'm there in that situation, in that story, I think I might have been a little bit indignant. Because here's this man again for 38 years, and he's participating in this formula that he thinks he can save himself, that he thinks by dipping in into this water that he's going to be cured. And if I'm there and I've watched this man for 38 years live his life according to that type of theology, and then Jesus comes in and says, "Do you want to be cured? Do you want to be made well?" I probably would have said something to Jesus. I probably would have said something that would have been a little bit sacrilegious. I probably would have said something that would have been a little bit more offensive. Because, of course, for 38 years I've been here. For 38 years I'm living in this reality. For 38 years or however long I've been specifically at this pool, like, I am attempting to do this. Of course I want to be made well. Do you not see that I'm here? Do you not see the condition that I'm in? Why are you dismissing this? Why are you removing this from the conversation? Do you think I'm just here because I have nothing else to do? Do you think I'm bored? Do you think I'm just doing this for giggles and fun show for everybody? Do you think I like looking at the people? Do you think I like looking at their eyes when they look at me in this demeaning way? And it's not the empathy, it's this freaking pity. Do you really think I want to be here because of this? Of course I want to be made well. That's why I'm here. And if we can, again, get into the human experience. But I also think when Christ is asking that question, that there's something a little bit deeper that he's asking of this invalid. Do you want to be made well? And I think it's this. Have you grown too comfortable in your dysfunction? Have you grown so comfortable in your dysfunction that you identify yourself as the simple broken person? That mat is your identity, that the mat and the brokenness and all of the hurt and everything about it, that's how you identify yourself. That's how you interact with the world. That's how you let the world interact with you. Do you want to be made well? Because are you willing to, again, allow this dysfunction not to be part of your identity? Do you really believe this? Because if you do, it has to be more than something of just a sentiment. For us to apply this, for you to really be made well, it has to be more than just an intellectual assent. You can't just simply agree. You're going to have to live this out. Now, if you do want to live this out, understand there are going to be some implications. Some things are going to have to change. So that question, I think, is posed in a different way. I think he's asking the invalid, has your dysfunction become the largest part of your identity? Have you grown too comfortable in your dysfunction? And I love, again, the invalid's response, because I think it's the best gospel articulation you see when he says, "Sir, I have no one. I can't do this. I can't do this by myself. I have tried. I've tried to figure out every single way. I've tried to figure out every formula. I've tried to figure out every little mechanism. I've tried to figure out the best way possible. I've attempted to build this, but I can't do it. I've tried and I can't. And if we can pause right there, you know what actually ticks me off too is the community that he's in. Because for 38 years, he's attempting to leverage himself into the pool, but one person couldn't stop whatever it was that they wanted to do and have a conversation with this invalid to get him into the pool? You really mean to tell me that one person couldn't stop and to gather some of the resources and gather the community and gather the people and say, hey, when that angel comes down and dips his hand in the pool, let's get this man, let's stop. Let's actually refrain from our life for one moment and allow this man to live free. One person couldn't do that. Do you really mean to tell me that? And I have to wonder too, is that embodying your faith? Maybe it's too early to talk about. Maybe I don't have enough equity with you. I get it. But I have to question you in the same truth and in the same gentleness. Is your faith more about you? Or is your faith more about leveraging your rights and deferring your responsibilities for the betterment of another? Because those are two different faiths. If it's about you, no religion at all, and it's worthless. But if it's about the other, and it's about the advancement of the kingdom of God, and it's building, again, disciples, party on. But you mean to tell me that these people couldn't stop and pause their lives for this one? So when he says, again, sir, I can't do it, I think that's the gospel. Because what Christ is able to do in this moment is what man has never been able to do, and it's save himself. Because what we see throughout Scripture, we see in the Old Testament, is that the law reveals our inability to keep it. We can't do it. It reveals our unrighteousness. It reveals all of these things about us that we cannot change. But the gospel is the good news, and the good news is that Christ is able to do that which you cannot. He can save you. Now, I understand, all gloves off, some of you guys don't even believe that you need to be saved. I get it. And I feel like I'm saying some things that I don't have enough equity in. So I do hope if I've offended you that you will come to me. But right now, I feel like there's a good portion of you guys that are needing to decide, that you're needing to simply hear that this gospel, that Christ sees you, that he has accepted you, that he is attempting to redeem your story completely. That there is no place that you have gone that he hasn't already redeemed. There is nothing that you can do that he cannot restore. There is nothing that you haven't or will do that he cannot somehow come in and save. That's the good news. So when Christ says, get up, take your mat and walk, I don't think that this is void of, again, the invalid having some concerns. Because that would be so scary at that point, if we're being completely honest. Because what if I attempt to get up and I can't? What if I attempt to feel and I can't? What if I attempt to stand and I only fall? Like, what if the people will make fun of me even more? What if they'll tell these stories? Or what about, what will I say to myself? Did I not have enough faith? Because this is going to change some stuff. He leans into these concerns. He dares greatly. He somehow dares bravely. He gets up. He takes his mat and he walks. And I love that phrase, take up your mat. Take up that thing which used to identify you, the dysfunction by which you used to, again, outline your life, and you take that and you put it on your back. Don't leave it. Let it be part of your story. And when people are asking you, but wait a minute, weren't you that invalid? Yep, that was me. Let me tell you a story about Jesus. Let me tell you, because your story and my story is nothing more than the retelling of his story. And his story is a natural prejudice. And at the heart of God, he pursues you in an attempt to redeem and restore all of us. That's the story. And I love that he gets up and he takes his mat and he begins to walk. And sadly, again, he's encountered by these religious leaders. Right? It's them. It would never be us. It would never be, again, the body of believers in the community that would come up and be like, wait a minute. no, you're not supposed to be carrying your mat today. Because we, the people, right, the people of the gospel, the Easter people, the Christmas people, the people that traffic in hope, right, us, like, we would see again transformation, we would see a miracle, and we would applaud, and we would celebrate with them, and we would be incredibly excited, and we would say, wait a minute, I've seen you for all of these years, like, I've seen you, and now you're walking, like, wait a minute, tell me what that was like. Did you feel it? Did you feel a little bit of, like, blood coming in your legs? Did you feel like your muscles getting stronger? Did you, so what was that like? What were your first steps like? What is this like? What is it like in the everyday life, too, when people are looking at you, and you know that they're looking at you because you're the invalid, but now you're not. Like, what was that like? We would be so excited, right? And you see these religious leaders come up and they're like, oh, but you're not supposed to do that. It's the Sabbath. But can I tell you, I love his response. I love the invalid's response because it's so authentic to, again, him. And he's like, I don't know where the man is. I don't know really kind of who he was. What I do know is that he healed me and he told me to walk. And I'm gonna walk. And I'm gonna walk all over this place because if you would have healed me and you would have told me to walk, I'll walk how you want me to walk, but you didn't. He did. He told me to walk, so I'm gonna walk. And if it offends you, I'm sorry. It's just that he is the one that healed me. You're the one that walked by me. So I'm gonna walk, and you're right, if I got a little hitch in my giddy up, if I got a little limp, if I have this, it's okay, because I'm gonna embrace that, because that was part of my story. Because what I'm realizing is that God is attempting to work all things for the good, not that all things are good, because pain is pain and hurt is hurt, and don't pretend it's something else. It's hurtful, but somehow what we know is that in the soil of our life, God takes all of those things and all, even the manure, and he puts it under into the rich soil, because that soil is going to produce a rich harvest, because that's the word of God, and his seed never comes back void. Because we know that, and we're going to cultivate that within our own life. And if you had done that, I'll walk how you want me to walk. But I figured the only evidence and the only testimony and the only, again, thing that I need to know is I encountered Christ. This is what my life was like before. This is what my life is like now. And I'm going to walk. You guys, I just want to leave you with a real simple kind of question. I'm not pretending that, again, all of our circumstances are going to change, because I don't think that's biblical. I think what we're called to look at is to change our perspective. That when we look into, again, the eyes, and when we read Scripture, and when we engage in an authentic way with Christ, he's not saying, I'm going to change all of your circumstance. And in fact, what he's saying is, you just keep your eyes up on me. You and I, like, you stay here. You keep your eyes on me. Don't you worry about all your circumstances. Don't you worry about all of those things. I got it. I know it's broken, and I know your parents are getting divorced again, and I know your parents hate each other, but they won't get divorced. And I know people are saying these things about you. I know you have some issues, and I know there's brokenness, and I know you're hearing these lies in your head about who do you think you are, and you're not telling them, I'm the Son of the Most High, or I'm the daughter of the Most High, the King of Kings and the Lords of Lords. I am, again, the son and the daughter of the Messiah. Like, we're not responding that. And I know these things are going on, but I believe what he's asking us to do is just simply keep our eyes up on him. He'll take care of all of this. He'll take care of those circumstances. You just keep your eyes on him. And we walk humbly, we walk boldly, we walk authentically with him. And when people ask you why, a simple response is, I know what my life was like before. I know the worldview that I thought I was building. I know the faith that I thought I was participating in, but it was bogus. It had all these formulas, but yet it wasn't true with reality. It had all of these arguments, but it was missing truth. It had all of these, like, nice constructed little philosophies, but it lacked one thing, Christ. It was a lie. I believed I could save myself. I believed that participating in these things, I could do it. Because every single one of us, I believe, will make a confession and realize, I cannot do it by myself. And we will acknowledge and point out this theology of I can do all things, period, not through Christ. This theology of pride and of hard work and hustle and all of that, that it's empty and it's fleeting and it's bogus and it's not the gospel. And we'll say, Christ, I can't do it. I can't do it by myself. I've been trying for 14 and 15 and 16 and 17, 18 years. I've been lacking this. And he says, exactly, now you get it. It was never about you. It's always been about me. Final question. If he has embraced your story, all of the good, all of the bad, all of the ugly, why can't you? So, Father, we thank you for this time this morning. Holy Spirit, we invite you into the places, into the ugly, into all of the things in which we want to keep hidden, even from ourselves, especially those around us. We ask that we would dare greatly, that we would look courageously to truth, not to what we want to believe in, but the truth. The truth, again, that sets us free. The truth that allows us to live in this life of abundance and wholeness and healing. It is not lacking, again, brokenness. It is not lacking hurt. But we're acknowledging that. We're living more truthfully. Father, I pray specifically for the students in here that are having a hard time embracing all of their story because of things that they've done, that they would hear the words, they are loved, they are accepted, they are worthy, and that should they look in the mirror and see anything other than, again, an accepted and worthy and loved child of God, that they either need to get a different mirror or they need to look a little longer until they see what you see. So, Father, we thank you for this. We thank you for your son, and all God's people said, amen.